Thank you very much, everybody. It's nice to be here and wonderful to see you all. We are not used to having a stage up here.
I like it.
You like it?
Yes.
And I like it too. So I'm going to take a little wild guess and assume that many of you are unfamiliar with not only the work that we're about to discuss, but the composer of the work. And it is, in fact, an interesting little quirk of history that this piece, this opera, The Birds, opened in 1920 and was very, very successful. It had a run of something like 50 performances where it opened in Munich. I've got it written down here, but I'm just going to wing it. And it received several other performances. It was very, very highly thought of by the conductor of the first performance, who was none other than Bruno Walter. And its lapse from the European repertory is a little bit baffling, and I think you'll agree when you see it, and when you listen to the musical excerpt we're going to play today, it's tremendously appealing. And the story is delightful, and the characters and the writing for the voice is very grateful, the orchestration is beautiful. So it did require, however, this composer did require some kind of bringing back out of obscurity into the public eye. He's not the first composer that can be said of Monteverdi, Handel when it comes to operas, Vivaldi. All of them were, as surprising as it may seem to us today, completely unknown, say 125 years ago. So Walter Braunfels was born in Frankfurt in 1882. So what that puts him in terms of his generation, 10 years, or not quite 10 years younger than Arnold Schoenberg, about a generation younger than Gustav Mahler and Richard Strauss, certainly in the post-Wagner period, which I think is probably, again, difficult for us to quite relate to this, but Wagner would have been one of the most massive elephants in any room. Even at this time, at the time when Walter Braunfels was growing up. He was born into an extremely musical family. His father died when he was three, so the paternal influence is probably not absolutely strong, but his mother had played with Liszt, and he had an older sister who took piano lessons from none other than Clara Schumann. So it was a very cultured family that he was born into. And he himself took piano lessons and played certainly well enough to give recitals of very advanced music. So he was, in fact, partly a professional concert pianist as well as a composer. Somewhere around his 12th birthday, he came into contact with a composer who would remain militantly conservative, militantly anti-modernist, a composer named Hans Pfitzner. I don't know really much about him myself. I know he's well known. But he did write an opera called Palestrina. And I was confronted with this the last time we presented Inside Opera last Sunday because a friend of mine came up to me afterwards and said, please don't ever do Palestrina.
Oh.
Because he said, I saw it when I was living in New York. I saw it at the Met, and it's suicidally boring.
Oh.
So, so it was not surprising then that Walter Braunfels resisted the idea of going into serial music or music that could be described as atonal. He didn't pursue that path. So Timothy will talk to you a little bit about any similarities that may occur between the style of music that Braunfels writes. It's very individual, but at the same time, it certainly represents the music that was being heard in his country, in his culture at the time. Now, one of the things about The Birds is that Braunfels got the idea around 1913. A year later, a composer named Alban Berg got the idea to write Wozzeck. So it is almost contemporaneous to that. Braunfels had always considered himself an avid classical scholar, so he was drawn to the idea of giving a kind of modernized version of Aristophanes' comedy. Now, when we think of the Greek tragedies, we think of works that have been living in some way or another ever since they were first produced. They're living as literature, perhaps more than as live theater, but they are part of our culture. The comedies were very, very topical, so many of the references would be completely lost today, as in fact many of the comic references in Shakespeare are. So it's less common to find a setting of a Greek comedy. Herb, where are you? There's Herb, who actually saw the first production, the premiere of a modernized version of The Frogs in the swimming pool at Yale with music by Stephen Sondheim. I wish I could have been there with you, but I had to wait until the revival in 2004.
I wish you could have.
Thank you. So it's something that came naturally to Braunfels to explore the potential of creating a classical work in a modern German context. And so, of course, World War I intervened, as it did for Baird, and the work didn't get produced on the stage until 1920. And one of the people who liked it was a fellow named Adolf Hitler. And Hitler ultimately would ask Braunfels to compose an anthem for the Third Reich, which Braunfels indignantly refused to do. What Hitler didn't know at the time was that although Braunfels was in fact a practicing Protestant who then converted to Catholicism, he was also half Jewish. And that would become common knowledge, so that a successful teacher, a successful composer, and a successful pianist was banned from all these professions and from making any public appearances in 1933. He survived, however, but he went into a kind of what's described as an internal exile. So he had no voice. And he continued to compose. He cultivated an interest in chamber music. A composer that I have not mentioned is Johannes Brahms. And to my ears, when I listen to a little bit of Braunfels' chamber music, I hear the influence of Brahms, who also cultivated chamber works for larger ensembles than quartets. You can see what you think. So in 1948, he was able to restore himself to his former position, except the public had become kind of interested in moving on, I suppose. He never reclaimed his earlier success, so it was kind of bittersweet for him, but he was able to put his music in front of the public again. So I think those were the main points I wanted to make about his life. One itsy-bitsy thing. When he was still in his teens, he made a decision that many parents encouraged their own children to make, which was to take up another profession, or at least to pursue something else at university. So he took up legal and economic studies. But the next year he moved to Munich, which was just so incredibly artistic. He got a chance to expose himself to Wagner's Ring and Tristan und Isolde, and he heard performances of the symphonies of Mahler and the music of Strauss. So that was extremely formative for him, so he decided to pursue music full time. He studied with Theodor Leschetizky. Now, if this were a room full of pianists, you all know exactly who I was talking about. Leschetizky's most famous pupil is probably Arthur Schnabel. You all know about Arthur Schnabel. And Leschetizky had been a pupil of Liszt. And one of my teachers, Robin Wood, studied with a pupil of Leschetizky as well. And Liszt, of course, studied with Czerny, who studied with Beethoven. So we can put our all the way back to that. And like almost any composer until fairly recently, Braunfels was not only an excellent pianist, but a great improviser. So this is leading to something else. Braunfels began to visit the home of a cultured enthusiast named Adolf von Hildebrandt, who had a young daughter named Bettel. And she and Walter Braunfels fell in love. So she broke off her engagement, which was to Wilhelm Furtwängler. So this is quite a social circle this guy's living in. And she had become one of Braunfels' piano students, so that is also a history that is repeating itself. And Furtwängler always spoke warmly of Braunfels' music, so that, you know, nothing great was lost. The conversion to Catholicism is an interesting one, because it may have influenced a departure from the Aristophanes original, which appears in Act Two of The Birds. And Timothy and I will discuss this, and I'm going to play you part of a recording of this. But it's time for me now to introduce the person who made this possible, really. And our infrastructure at POV has been very enthusiastically supporting Timothy's choice of this repertoire, because for the past at least 25 years, we've had this tradition. What did George refer to it as? The meat in the sandwich. We don't generally do two really, really popular top 10 operas a year ever, but we do one, awesome, and then we'll do one that's not exactly off the beaten track, but is less frequently produced. And the third opera that we're doing this season counts as that, because Cosi fan tutte did not get its North American premiere, I read, until 1926 or some such thing. But in the middle, we have this interesting, wonderful work from Britain to Strauss, to Janáček, to Lee Hoiby, to Jonathan Dove that isn't something that's expected in a Canadian city of this size. And they've been some of our most successful offerings. So it's very exciting to talk about this one because it's a composer from a generation that makes us think he should be known better. So we're doing our bit. So please welcome to the platform the company's artistic director, Maestro Timothy Vernon.
Two to ten, we do get a dinner table. But actually, you know, before we get into things, I'm here to defend Fitzner and Palestrina. Please do. So Palestrina gets a sort of homage every year in Vienna, or at least it did, all the years I was a student there, and you see it once. Maybe you felt once was enough, but it's still an interesting work. Your talk about it sort of took me back to it. And Fitzner's a very able composer, and this work is not without interest at all. And since it's based on a musician, a composer, a great composer, it's kind of interesting. I mean, it consists of a sort of protracted version of the scene in Macbeth, where all the kings pass by one at a time. And so in this work, you see a bunch of famous composers, and Fitzner kind of weaves some of the ideas from their music into a score. So it's not without interest.
I'm just quoting somebody else, I'm interested. Now on that note though, we're going to refocus on Braunfels. You were the person who brought this idea to the company. I'd just like to ask you what your response is to the music. How would you describe the music of either the Birds or Braunfels in general?
Well, superficially it's quite beautiful. It makes a beautiful impression because it's written in an idiom that we now know 100 years later. You've referred to Wagner, you've referred to Brahms, and it's interesting to see the ways in which they contribute to Braunfels' musical imagination. Don't think you're going to hear some pastiche of other famous composers, because he has his own voice, he has his own idiom. I would say from Wagner, he learned the idea of the through line, the use of the orchestra to tell the story, not just to accompany, but to illustrate what's going on. From Brahms, he got a more rigorous sense of form, which in Wagner is sometimes elusive. That's not a put-down, it's Wagner invented a new form as he went, which is, you know. So, whereas Brahms harked back to Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven, Schubert, and so, in terms of the structure of his music. And Braunfels has this underlying structure. I took the trouble when I started studying the thing, to analyze it in terms of its building blocks, the phrases, and how they interlock, and what the motifs are like, and all of that. And it revealed itself to be very grounded in classical compositional procedures. On the surface, though, it's an interesting use of chromaticism, you know what that is, compared to regular classical harmony and its progressions. Braunfels he has a lot of chromaticism, which is unlike Wagner's, which often remains unresolved and suspended. He does resolve these things, but his the modernism that you hear in the score, it's not offensive at all, but it consists mostly of prolonged resolutions. So there'll be a longer period where the dissonance hangs in the air and doesn't land. And so that gives it an edge, a kind of musical edge. It keeps you focused, it keeps your attention, because it doesn't always answer on time the expectation we have of the cadence, that's the finish of a phrase, and getting to the main key or to a subsidiary key that makes sense. I'm sure none of that makes any sense to you, but I just thought I'd throw it out. He writes, as Robert already indicated, idiomatically for the voice. Every great opera composer seems to have an innate sense of what the voice can do and should do, and of its beauty and of the qualities, and how to expose that, and how to use that for the expression of inner states, which is really mostly what opera's about. There was an Englishman, whose name I can't remember, he wrote a rather fatuous book about opera in the days of deconstruction, and he called it a song of love and death. Okay, you know, as far as it goes, that kind of sums it up. And you say, well, what about comedy? Well, we all know that comedy is just an inversion of the story of death and prolongation. So there is that in it. There is that in it, the direct emotive expression. But there's also this layer of fantasy, because it is a work of fantasy. It's not verismo. It's the farthest thing, because, of course, as Robert's indicated, he makes it difficult because there's not much left to talk about. So, yes, it's true he was a classicist, and so it's true that his going to Aristophanes is not, unexpected. He knew the original Greek, and he the Attic Greek in which it is written. And of course, Aristophanes was a satirist. So Aristophanes was not so concerned with plot. It's not like the Shakespearean line. It's more of an examination of a state of being, if you like, or a state of society, because Aristophanes would parody contemporary individuals who represented things. Cleon, in the case of politics, Socrates, in the case of philosophy, Euripides, in the case of the other side of the drama, the tragedy. So Aristophanes was up on all of this, and he also was a great punster. Now that's something without knowing Attic Greek that you don't really get. Even the very idea of this piece is based on a pun or a kind of an idiom in Attic Greek, which I understand from my daughter, who is a classicist, I'm not. That there's a phrase, go to the crows or go with the crows, which has in the day a meaning of getting lost or losing yourself or evolving to a place outside society, go with the crows, you know. And so there's that very beginning in terms of the treatment of the birds and how that all happens. He used the Aristophanic setup, the exposition, namely Act 1, pretty faithfully, but when he gets into Act 2, he goes way off, and he completely rewrites the second half of the opera to coincide more with his ideals. It is, in a way, an idealistic work. I wouldn't say naive, but certainly an innocent work. And it doesn't have the sort of carping nastiness that you find in Aristophanes, who, while he's carping and nasty, is also very funny. I have to take it on faith, but you know. I mean, you read the translations and you get a kind of glimpse of what that is. But of course, the contemporary references, I mean, you know, it's tough. How do you translate Saturday Night Live in a,
In 2,000 years from now.
Yeah, 2,000 years later, yeah. Makes sense of it. Aristophanes is much greater than Saturday Night Live.
Even the original.
So he found this story to be very sympathetic, and it remains probably his most popular work. You mentioned Bruno Walter, and I'll tell you the truth. I mean, I told the cast a joke. I said, you know, who told me about this opera was Bruno Walter. And of course, unfortunately, it wasn't directly. He, Bruno Walter, came to conduct in Canada when I was about 12 years old. In fact, it was, do people remember Nicholas Goldschmidt?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Known in the business affectionately as Nicholas Schmidt Goldass. Because he left debts everywhere he went. But he had initiative, and he brought Bruno Walter and Herbert von Karajan to Vancouver, BC to conduct within 2 weeks of each other. How about that? So Walter gave an interview on the CBC, and the CBC was always on in our household, so if I wanted to hear it or not, it was there. And here he was. Now, by that age, I had already fallen desperately in love, particularly with Mozart, and Bruno Walter's Mozart was famous, so I knew who he was, and he became a kind of idol for me, right? So when he gave this interview, I was all ears, and at one point in the interview, he stopped to ask the interviewer, do you know the composer father took wild verse. And of course, the interviewer, he said, ah. So he started to describe this opera, Die Vögel, which he himself had conducted in 1920, and Robert's already mentioned. And the way he described it was such warmth and such, it gave me a vision of something. And for some reason, it stuck. There were two brain cells at the back where it went and stayed all those decades. And when the recording came out, which is in the late 90s, and there is only one CD, there's now a DVD from Los Angeles, but it costs a couple $100 because it's out of print. When this was recorded, it was in the series Decca produced called Entartete Kunst, which means decadent art. And of course, decadent because of the Jewish factor. And it's also interesting, you mentioned half Jewish. Well, it was the wrong half. And this shows that the Nazis never read the Torah. Because if they had, they'd know that it's matrilinear. The father was Jewish, the one who died when he was three. So in terms of, what can you say?
Authenticity.
They made a big mistake.
Among
many others. So, but his conversion to Catholicism, one can say, was a bit unfortunate. Not from a theological point of view. I'm speaking strictly as a musician, because what happened is he started to write liturgical works based on Catholic liturgy, of course. And they got drier and drier and drier as he progressed, and he lost that verve and that kind of sensuality, yes, sensuality, which was a part of his musical imagination when he was younger. So the use of the orchestra, the voice, and everything else, it became sort of more formalized, one could say.
Which helps explain perhaps why he didn't find his...
Well, there's that too. And of course, the movement of history, you mentioned Berg, and he was, he coincided with the growth of atonality. And by the time in his maturity, he was seen as being old-fashioned, in a funny way, sort of like Korngold. Korngold had a different escape to Hollywood, but he was unfashionable. He became old-fashioned. And of course, we're now going back to that, because we realize that atonality and all of its descendants is a kind of a dead end. Not to say that it wasn't some kind of inevitability historically. And I would remind you, if you shake your head and say, atonality, it's only an idiom. And any idiom can be picked up by a man or woman of genius and made into something fantastic. So I would put it to you that while it's not tonal, Wozzeck is as great an opera as anybody ever wrote. So there.
I think you're preaching to the converted because it's sold out.
Okay. So where are we with that? Yes, the orchestra, it's a basically a classical size orchestra, the same size orchestra as you'd have for Carmen, with the addition, one more harp, so there's two harps, a celesta, a wind machine. How wonderful is that?
There are not enough wind machines on stage.
No, unfortunately not. Now, the orchestra's a little too big to put all of it in the pit. So we have this long-standing usage of putting the percussion section into what we call the cage, which is offstage near the loading dock, and piping them into the hall. It seems to work very well. None of you will come up to me and say, what's this with the percussion in the cage and the balance and the thing? So it obviously it's been working for us. So we're going to put all the percussion in the cage along with the wind machine.
I was in the cage for Daphne.
Yes, you were. That's absolutely correct.
And I was so grateful because I only played for about 7 bars. And if I'd been in the pit, I'd have to sit there for the whole night.
Why did Strauss do that sort of thing?
Same thing with Capriccio. I played harpsichord for, 3 minutes?
Yeah.
And that's 2.5 hours with no intermission.
Well, I was talking to somebody who got a contract to play Salome with the COC in Toronto. And I said, he said, yes, the organ part. I said, the organ part? I said, it's 5 chords. He said, exactly.
So we've gotten a little bit off topic. So you mentioned, that's okay. You mentioned the orchestra in the German tradition, or the Austro-German tradition of being an equal partner in the telling of the story. And what this usually means is that there are either leitmotifs that are introduced, little fragments of melody that are meant to conjure up ideas or people, characters, things, but also primarily that there's counterpoint in an orchestra, which we don't always associate with an accompaniment.
No, that's true. I mean, if you think that the furthest extreme into even bel canto, although Bellini writes some lovely melodies for the orchestra, it's not a thick underpinning. Neither is the early Verdi. We make jokes about bon papa, bon papa, because that's what's there. Whereas the traditions are, I mean, if you put this work into some kind of context historically, think with me quickly about the magic flute. Der Freischützenweber, and by the same composer, Oberon, and then Mendelssohn, in Summer Night's Dream, and then Wagner's very first opera, The Fairies, Die Feen, and then all of Strauss' lead parts appeal to classical mythology. That's that sort of line of the fantastic in music. And all of those composers were gifted contrapuntalists, and of course this goes way back to Father Bach, not Haydn, Bach, who was the source of everything. You know, Schumann himself said, "Das ist kein Bach." Bach is a brook or a little stream in English. He said, "Das ist kein Bach, das ist ein Meer." That's not a stream, that's an ocean. And that's true. Bach is sort of at the source of this particular tradition, and it was fruitful for centuries and centuries. So that's the sort of musical provenance of this piece, and you're right. It's not, the melodies are there, they're lovely, and you'll hear some. But the orchestra part is just as important. And it's also pretty dense. There's a web of not just melodies, but figuration. So the string section, we have first, second, violins, viola, cello, and bass. Normally they're playing a single line, the whole section plays a single line. In his case, he's taken the sections apart. So there's up to four parts, first violin, three or four parts, second violin, three viola parts, cellos. So it gives it a mesh of sound, a kind of woven, a web that keeps moving through the harmonies and keeps it kind of a shimmer of shimmers, which is characteristic. I mean, you think, I've been using the word phantasmagoria or phantasmagoria, which is to describe the piece, because phantasm, you know, a kind of something dreamlike, visionary, you know, unusual. And phantasmagoria is a word that was invented in the very beginning of the 19th century to describe the effect of those magic lanterns that they had, the very early predecessors of the movies. So these magic lanterns that went round and round and round, and they could be engineered such that things would appear larger and smaller and faster and slower and all of that. And they were considered magic. So phantasmagoria was made up, a made-up word to describe the experience you have with the magic lantern. And I think there's a kind of magic lantern aspect to this show. Of course, they're birds, so what does that mean? That means the costume department is overworked. and, you know, I'll be surprised if there are any feathers left in Victoria. No, but of course it involves, you know, wonderful headpieces, beaks, all that kind of stuff. And it also involves them learning, the chorus, learning to have a sort of bird-like aspect. So we've had quite hysterical times of them learning to hop, and learning to do it's fascinating, and it's wonderful. And of course we have Jacques Lemay assisting with that, and he always astonishes me, because I don't think there's any situation where he couldn't find the appropriate gesture. He's just so adept and fast. Anyway, so
I think that is enough to make us all want to go.
Yeah.
Shall we just see something? The role originally was played by somebody, if you're an opera buff, with a historical bent, Maria Ifogun, sang the first performances of The Nightingale. Now, this is, again, I believe, a classical tradition. The work begins with a prologue. and we get welcomed, the audience gets welcomed into the amphitheater, and we get an idea of what we're about to witness, although she does say something about having a kind of longing herself that will become apparent later. So we're going to play you the prologue. The prologue will consist, first of all, of some of the most ravishing orchestral music, and then the singing, which may remind you of many of Strauss' caroling.
Well, yeah, it's true. There's just to say, there people. I've seen references to Zerbinetta. You've seen Zerbinetta, if possible, twice, because we produced Ariadne of Naxos twice. And Zerbinetta is that wonderful figure who has these brilliant, very high set acrobatic arias, right, that are stunning. And of course, people say, oh, that's so, it's got to be so hard. Well, for the right voice, not so much. You know what I mean? If you've got the goods, if you've got that particular voice and the command of it, you can manage. This is in the same range, but it's not quite as acrobatic. It's more lyrical. There's more sustained line, but it stays up there. Think of the Queen of the Night, but not just popping up a note, but getting up there and staying on that plane. It's kind of exciting, actually, just vocally. So
we'll hear that. If you did attend Flight, the character played by Charlene Joint is also something.
Oh yeah, that's another one. Yeah, she could sing this one, for example, also.
Self-serving, interested in the acquisition of power?
Yes, it's true. He has a lot of elements in him. He has some Sancho Panza, he has some Leporello, he has some Cuvinal, in the style of the writing. So he's like the friend, the companion, the guy on the road trip who's always getting people in trouble.
Or birds. And then Hufflepuff is a more idealistic
Yes, it's a tenor part. It's like a very junior Haydn tenor. It doesn't have that kind of beef, but it's in the German tenor tradition. And it's very sympathetic. He's a total idealist, and there's great warmth and aspiration in his role.
And he has a duet with the Nightingale. So yeah. You can look forward to that. You have to buy a ticket to see or hear that. In a nutshell, the first act sets up Rattenfreund persuades the king of the birds. How do you pronounce that one? Hoopo. He persuades them to sort of stage a rebellion against the gods and to erect a kind of bird fortress or citadel so that they can intercept the smoke that comes up to the heavens from the sacrifices made by the people on earth, and without that the gods will wither and starve. So that appears to be a kind of war. Now, one of the commentators that I've been able to track down about Braunfels suggests two things. First of all, his own experience in the First World War would have been recent and would have influenced his reaction against any kind of such confrontation. But also, his conversion to Catholicism imbues him with the principle of Christian obedience. So in any case, this is introducing something that is not from Aristophanes, the introduction of Prometheus. And Prometheus is there to tell the birds that this is a ridiculous idea, it's a terrible idea, they must not do it. And he recounts his own experience defying God and being punished for it. So I'm going to play a little bit of that. This is a god, in other words. And the birds, under the influence of Rattenfreund, ignore this, kind of like Wotan and Erda, I guess. This is a warning being ignored. And of course, inevitably leading into some difficulty. So, I'm going to play a bit of this. This is a baritone role. Anything you'd like to say?
No, it's just that there's a classical motif here too, which is the Greek idea of hubris, overweening pride. And we all know what that precedes. So pride going before of all, and that's what Prometheus is coming to tell this creature. And you know the expression, cloud cuckoo land. That's it, cloud cuckoo land, this fortress in the sky.
People asked last time, the soprano's name is, how can I boss it? Helen Kwan. Not a household name. The next one is closer to a household name. This is Matthias Gerner.
Oh, Matthias Gerner. Wonderful young
baritone. Don't think he's so young anymore.
Unless they made this.
Thank you. we have ready to...
Yeah, well, you know, it occurred to me while listening that both these excerpts have a kind of expansive pace to them. And you might think, oh gosh, this opera's slow. No. In the second act, because he was writing for a big theater in Munich, he wrote a very extensive ballet sequence, which is the marriage of the doves and also the symbolical dedication of the city, which is something the Greeks were really into. It was a big deal for them. And so he made this scene, which is quite extended and has a lot of very zippy tunes in it. And of course, the difficulty is we don't have a court of ballet. So Glynis and Jack are, what do we do? Well, what we did was catalog it. and I'm sorry, because it's some of the charming and engaging music. But if you don't have the forces to make it real in terms of the drama, we did the right thing, I think. And of course, it's difficult because nobody knows this piece. I don't. I mean, I've never conducted a note of it before, and none of the singers have sung it. We all kind of knew of it, but that's a very different thing. And when you get to really work on a piece and you understand how the bones are buried and how it's going to come over theatrically, I think we did the right thing to make significant cuts in Act Two.
Yes, and speaking of doing the right thing, sometimes we're able to have Glynis along with us when we talk about these things, but she was not able to come today. I think that's the reason. Anyway, I would like you to just tell us a little bit about what we can expect to see. You can see some of the costume designs over there in some of the set, some photos of the set.
Well, yes, the costumes are wonderful. The singers are all excited about them, that they're having fittings and whatnot. Glynis sort of went back to the origin of the work. And since it started in 1913, it was composed through the First World War, in which Braunfels was a participant. She decided to start us off with the two human beings as soldiers in the trenches. So we get a recreation of World War I German trenches, which is quite fantastic. I don't know if there are any pictures of that. But our shop, who are so fantastic, every one of them a real artisan, they've created this fantastic look. And we're not stuck in the trenches through the opera, don't worry, that's where it starts. And then gradually it expands, the birds appear, and all of that. If you look over in that corner when you get up and you can move around, you'll see there's a pink frame looking thing, and there's another one behind it. If anybody remembers War Horse, do you remember War Horse?
Yes.
That fabulous puppet. So we have two sort of War Horse birdies over here. That are being manipulated by dancers, and they're quite extraordinary. For the rest, there's some really wonderful costuming and some incredible lighting. There's an oculus around the moon, that is to say, the projections on the moon itself, so it keeps changing as the story evolves. I think it's entrancing, myself, and what an opportunity for a designer, because it's all fantastical. So I think you're in for a treat visually.
And also, we have a fantastic cast.
Oh, well, can't say enough about them. And it's fascinating, our three main characters. So the Nightingale, who's played by Claire de Sévigné, who was here for the garden party at Carol's, and who was also here in this room singing a recital with her bestie, which is Aviva, who's been here many times. But Claire's never been on our main stage. Likewise, the tenor,
Adrian Kramer.
He's actually Mr. Cesaroni, because he's married to Lucia Cesaroni, who made her professional debut here. And in fact, her first two roles here, and has been back many times. And who else? Oh yeah, the Ratefreund is Peter.
Peter Barrett.
Peter Barrett. The Barrett family are quite well known, and his brother, Michael, was in Countess Maritza. And was cavorting around and lots of areas. But Peter actually was here, which I'd forgotten. It's terrible, but you know, it's been a long time ago. Strauss's favorite opera, and mine, is Daphne. And Peter Barrett was here as a shepherd. It's a very small part. He came out of school. He was in the Atelier in Montreal, and he came and sang this because I heard it in his lovely voice. Anyway, here he is, a Mormon juror guy, singing this fabulous role of Ratefreund.
So we, it's, and what else can we tell you? This is probably, if not a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, it's certainly not going to happen a great deal. So please enjoy, come to the Royal and enjoy it. And we'll look forward to seeing you there. So thanks very much to
Thank
all
you.
Of you for
Thank
being
you.
Here. Thanks to everybody at POE. And thanks to Nikki for joining us. And we'll see you at the opera.